my words be truth. I don't wanna say a word unless it points the world back to you. Let the words I say be the sound of yours. Healing words. That's as Jan said, our series. We're focused on healing words, healing words of Jesus in particular. It's interesting because after he resurrected from the dead, before he ascended to heaven, he made seven different statements that were healing statements, healing words for the disciples who were, you know, cowering, afraid, and confused because of their hurt, their loss, and their doubts. And we're just like them. We encounter hurt, loss, and doubts, and we need healing words, even on a day like Mother's Day. I feel like it's important to say this because we say Happy Mother's Day to so many women, and it's a joyful thing for so many women, and yet there are a lot of women and also men for whom it's a very painful day. There's a lot of hurt. There are women who have not been able to have children. There are women and men who have lost children. There are those of us who have lost mothers. And so Mother's Day, while it's so joyful, it can also be incredibly painful. We run into hurt in so many places in our lives, sometimes expected, sometimes not. And so we need Jesus' healing words. My hope is that you have had a mom in your life that has spoken healing words to you. Some do, some don't. Some don't. Here's an example of one that doesn't. This lady was shopping one day in the grocery store. And had a cart full of groceries. She saw this guy across the aisle, and she approached him, complete stranger, and she said, "Excuse me, I hate to bother you, but you remind me so much of my son who passed away recently." And he said, "Oh, I'm so sorry. Is there anything I can do for you?" And she said, "Well, as a matter of fact, there is. Would you mind just as I exit, you know, after checking out, would you mind just saying goodbye, Mom? To me, just waving and saying goodbye, Mom." And he said, "Well, I can do that, sure." And he was right behind her in the line, and she went through, and she's walking out. She gets to the threshold. She looks back, and he says, "Bye, Mom." And she waves, and she takes off. He only has a few items, and he gets up there, and he sees the bill is $127.50. And he said, "Well, what's up with that? I only have a few things." And the clerk said, "Well, your mom said you'd pay for it for her." Some mothers are not as good as others. Maybe you've had some good advice from some mothers. We have a lot of things that mothers say to us that can really guide us through life. Here's some examples. Maybe you've heard this. Make sure you always have your own money. Don't take a bath when there's a lightning storm. Anybody ever heard that one from mom? Always wear clean underwear. You'll never know if you end up in the ER, right? Don't eat yellow snow, right? That's not a problem down here. Mind your manners. Be kind and love your sisters. Here's a good one. This too shall pass. I love that one. This too shall pass. Soap is cheap. There's no excuse to not be dirty. Or if you can't wash, look at the label if you have that. Mom, that's kind of funny, I thought, guys. Always pick your own battles. Never miss an opportunity to learn a new skill. Do your duty, even if there's no reward for it. Drink lots of water and don't eat fried foods. Moms can speak healing words into our lives. And my hope and prayer is that you've had that experience. And we want to honor moms who've spoken the healing words of God into our lives. Moms who give direction for living, guidance for living in this life. A lot of biblical moms set that example. So we can talk about mothers of the Bible. Think about the mom of Samson. Samson, get your hand out of that line. You don't know where it's been. Or David's mom, "I told you not to play in the house with that sling. Go practice your harp. We pay a lot for those lessons." Or Cain's mom, Eve, right? "Get off your brother. You're going to kill him." Ah, come on. That's a groaner, at least. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Or Judas's mom, "Have you been in my purse again?" Oh, yeah. Or Jesus's mom, Mary, "Stop working on that wood and come in to eat. You'd spend your whole life on that wood if your father asked you to." Ooh, yeah, that's a deep one, isn't it? Yeah, moms can speak guidance and healing into our lives. But as I said earlier, even they, along with all of us, need the healing words of Jesus. And the challenge for all of us in that, sometimes we have pride in our lives, we feel like we can kind of control our lives, and we really block out the voice of God, the voice of Jesus speaking into our lives. That was the temptation for the original disciples. It's after the resurrection, Peter and the disciples are hurt, they're confused, they're afraid, and they go to do what's familiar, what they're good at. Remember that? They fish. They're fishermen. That's what these guys were experts at. They were like charter boat captains on the Sea of Galilee. And so they go out, they strike out at night, and they fish all night long. These are expert fishermen, by the way. And Jesus appeared, and he saw that they had caught nothing, and he gives them some healing words, some expert advice, some guidance. And they didn't let their own expertise stand in the way, because that's what happens so often. We feel so competent and so in control of our lives that we sort of don't really listen to what Jesus might have to say. But they show us the way. So here's how John describes this scenario in John chapter 21. It says, afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, don't you love that name, Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. I'm going out to fish, Simon Peter told them, and they said, we'll go with you. So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize it was Jesus. He called out to them, friends, have you caught any fish? As if he didn't already know. That's Jesus for you. No, they answered. He said, well, throw your net on the right side of the boat and you will find some. Now, if you were an expert fisherman and you knew this was a guy from Nazareth, a carpenter who's an inlander, what might you be tempted to think? Like, what does he think? What does he know? But this is what happened. It says that they threw their net on the other side, and they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, hey, it's the Lord. As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, it's the Lord, he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he'd taken it off, and he jumped into the water. Then the other disciples followed in the boat. That's like Peter just jumping in and leaving them all behind, and they're trying to catch up with him. And they're towing the fish. They were only 100 yards from shore. Don't you love those details in Scripture? I think that's so cool. When they landed, they saw a fire burning coals, and Jesus had fish on it, and he had some bread. And Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you just caught. So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat, dragged the net ashore, and it was full of large fish, 153. Now, why is that there? We're going to answer that question. But even with so many, the net was not torn. That's a very interesting fact as well. Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. None of the disciples dared ask, who are you? For they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took bread, and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. Now, this was the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. So what were the healing words? What did Jesus say that made the difference? Throw your net on the right side of the boat. And I just want to say, as strange as it might sound, that's the healing words for Jesus to you and me today. Now, what does that mean? I don't know. I don't know what that means for you. It means different things for each and every one of us. What is the net that is empty for you right now that needs to be filled? Because that's different for each one of us. And so Jesus has a different way of answering each of our unique needs. That's the gift, but also the mystery. But what can we know? We can know how the disciples got their net filled. We can know because they took what I kind of just simply calling four steps of faithfulness. And it's very simply this. Listen to Jesus. Listen to Jesus. Then follow Jesus' advice. Reap his rewards. Underline Jesus' rewards. And strengthen trust in Jesus. Now, we're going to walk through these. And I want you to kind of understand how this worked for them, because Peter and his disciples, they learned the importance of listening to Jesus, and it's so important. We're so bad at listening, aren't we? I mean, some of you are wandering off right now thinking about what you're going to have for lunch, what you're going to do this afternoon. We are so, so bad at listening. It affects all of our relationships. Peter was just as bad as we are. Earlier in his encounter with Jesus, remember they were up on a mountain this time, and Jesus was being transformed, transfigured, and Peter is blabbing at the mouth. He's not listening, and it's as if God came out of a cloud and said, "Hey, Peter, shut up. I love this guy. Listen to him." This is the way it actually goes in Matthew chapter 17. While he, Peter, was still speaking, a bright cloud covered them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." And I think God knew that Peter just needed that again and again. You need to stop talking and start listening better. We have a hard time listening. It affects all of our relationships. There's a great story that comes from Franklin Roosevelt, FDR. And he knew that people, you know, were just being formal in their approach to him. He would greet people in a long line, and they weren't listening to anything he said. So he started to mess with them. And he knew that, just to prove the point, he would say in a low voice, "I killed my grandmother this morning." And they would go, "It's so good to see you too, sir. God bless you. You're doing a great job, sir. It's an honor to meet you, sir." And he'd say, "I killed my grandmother this morning." And they were clueless. They weren't listening. Until the ambassador from Bolivia got in line, he actually listened and heard him say, "I killed my grandmother this morning." And he replied, "Well, she probably had it coming." The stakes are so high for us in listening. It affects everything. It affects everything. 85% of what we learn, we do so by listening. So in as much as you listen well, you learn well. And when we don't listen well, you know, it can affect things deeply. 75% of the time, we are distracted, we are preoccupied and forgetful while listening. 75% of the time. That's a problem for us. If 85% of the time, you know, what we listen to, we're learning, wow, we have an upward battle, uphill battle. We remember only 20% of what we hear 2 to 5 days later. So you're not going to remember much about this, are you? That's why we record it. You can go back and listen to it. It affects all of our relationships, as I said. Dr. John Gottman, arguably the world's leading researcher in marriage, says that not listening well is the number one reason for failed marriages. So no elbowing now next to anybody. We need to listen better. Even as a pastor, I mean, my wife reminds me all the time. Pastors are not any better than others because we are just as manic as can be. Another pastor who fell into this trap was someone you've heard of, or you've read, or you've heard preach, Chuck Swindoll, a great author and pastor. And going from morning to night with meetings and grabbing a bite with family in between and so on and so forth. And one day he's sitting at the dinner table with his little girl, and he's, you know, just choking down some food real fast because he's got to get to a meeting at the church. And so she wants to tell him something, and she's talking really fast so she can get it in real quick before he has to leave. And he realizes what's going on. He says, "Honey, you don't have to talk so fast. You don't have to talk so fast to tell me what you want to say. Say it slowly now." And then she looked at him and she said, "Then listen slowly." Ouch. It's not just for him, is it? It's all of us. We need to listen more slowly in all of our relationships, especially to Jesus. You ever think, "Oh God, where are you? You're not speaking to me. You're not in this in my life." Well, it's not his fault. He's speaking. I promise you. We're often not listening well. We need to listen more slowly. Peter and his disciples listen, but then it doesn't do any good to just listen and not do anything with what you hear. Right? They followed Jesus' advice. Following is a common verb in the New Testament with Jesus. John chapter 8, verse 12 says, "When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, 'I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.'" And notice, Jesus didn't say there will never be darkness. You will encounter darkness. You will encounter difficulty. You will encounter pain and suffering. But listen, if you're following Jesus, he's the light of the world. Wherever the darkness is that you're encountering, you have the light shining into it. That's how it works when you follow. But you only know where to go with Jesus if you're first listening. Listen and then follow. We need to learn to listen and follow better. We have a hard time following just like we have a hard time listening, don't we? Too often, we want to be in control. That's the issue with following. We want to be large and in charge of our lives, and we think we know what's best. One senior in high school was struggling with the fact that she had to fill in a question for a college application that asked, "Are you a leader?" And she didn't feel like she was a strong leader, that she was just a follower. And so she put no, and she thought, "Oh, there goes that college. They're not going to accept me." To her great surprise, she got a letter of acceptance back from the college. And it said this, "Dear applicant, a study of the application forms reveals that this year our college will have 1,452 new leaders. We're accepting you because we feel it is imperative that you have that they have at least one follower." Yeah. We all want to be the chief, don't we? Especially when it comes to our own lives. We got to listen. We got to follow. A disciple is a follower. You've been discipled in something. You learned how to work on a car or a lawnmower or how to do something administratively. You learned some skill. You learned some knowledge. Why? Because you followed somebody else's advice or example. That's what a disciple does. And a Christian disciple is a follower of Jesus. It's that simple. A follower of Jesus. So we listen, we follow, and then we reap. We reap. Peter and his disciples listened, followed, and then they reaped the rewards that Jesus had for them. That was all those fish in that net. And I'm sure Jesus wanted them to think at that moment of another time earlier in their ministry when they were in the desert, in the wilderness, and there were 5,000 people who were fed fish and loaves of bread, and make that connection that I will provide for you if you listen to me and follow me. You will reap. You will reap. In Galatians, Paul puts it this way, "Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows." Now, when I read something like that, I feel like I'm on thin ice because it gets like really close to prosperity gospel kind of stuff. And I have kind of an allergic reaction to prosperity gospel theology. You know, if you sow a certain amount of faith, well, your bank account's going to swell. You know, you're going to have material success and all this jazz. I think there is cause and effect. That's kind of obvious. But there's something deeper going on here. See, Jesus wants to meet our deepest needs and infuse new life, faith, hope, and trust, regardless of what difficulties you're going through, what challenges you're facing. You see, reaping the rewards are not the rewards we want from Jesus because we treat him like Santa Claus sometimes, don't we? But we have to kind of reevaluate and let him reorder what we value as rewards, receiving what he wants for us, not what we want from him. Do you get that? It's like the Tour de France. You know, have you ever seen the Tour de France on TV? It's like this torture cycling tour. They go 2,000 miles on a bicycle. Now, that would be like, if it was Florida in the wintertime, flat and cool, that would be torture enough. But this is in the French Alps, guys. There are mountains. And there is craziness. Look at those mountains. And they go 2,000 miles. A guy named Gilbert Duclos LaSalle describes it as an annual madness race. It's cold. It's hot. They have to eat while they're on a bike. I mean, think about how long it would take to go 2,000 miles. He practices by biking 22,000 miles every year just to train for this event. Now, what would inspire, what reward would inspire one? What do you think they get when they win the Tour de France? Maybe $100,000, maybe $1 million? Zero. They get the winner's jersey. That's it. Look at that. Yeah, so we're so used to what we value, but just finishing the race and getting a yellow jersey is enough. You see, we strengthen our trust in Jesus when we reap the reward He has for us, not what we want from Him. That's so important. Peter and the disciples strengthened their trust in Jesus. Paul, he says this in Colossians 2. So then, just as you receive Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in Him, regardless of what mountains you're climbing over. You can be strengthened for that. A strengthened trust in Christ is our deepest need amidst the challenges that we face. And we all have incredible challenges that we face in life. There's a story about a guy who was sitting around a campfire, and he put a pot of coffee on, and it was percolating, and he decided to fry some bacon in one of those big iron griddles, and it's sizzling. Suddenly hears this crazy noise coming through the forest. Unbelievable. He sees this cowboy riding, of all things, a grizzly bear. He's holding in his hand a 7-foot-long rattlesnake. The trees are being mowed down by his rampage through the woods. He comes to a skidding stop right there at the campfire. He jumps off the grizzly bear, bites the head off of the snake, punches the bear, knocks it out cold, grabs the hot pot of coffee, gulps it all down. He slurps the grease from the hot bacon and then eats all the bacon in one bite. He says, "Howdy, partner. I'd like to stay around a little while longer, but I can't. I got to keep going because there's a real bad dude chasing me." You know, no matter how strong you think you are, there's always something that can overwhelm you. There's always something that's stronger than your own willpower, stronger than your own ability to be in control of your life and to keep it all together. I promise you, there's always some bad dude. And why do we need Jesus' strength? Because we are chased by bad dudes. Now, what's your dude? What's your circumstance? What's the issue? It may not be something that's real obvious now. Just wait, there will be. There'll be something that overwhelms you where you're not strong enough. And that's why we need Jesus' words, His healing words, to speak to us now, to listen and to follow, to reap His rewards so that we can be strengthened in those moments. Or maybe like Peter, we need His strength because our very best efforts leave us empty. You ever done something where you put your all into it? You gave it your 100% honest effort best, and then it really didn't turn out like you expected? You felt like a failure. It came out empty. And so the question that I want us to leave with is this: where do you come up empty? Ask yourself that. Where do I come up empty? And the answer is different for all of us. There's always some place in us, around us, among us, within us. Maybe it's your faith, your spiritual walk, and you feel like, I just hit a dead end there, and I feel empty there. Maybe it's relationships or your family, and it just things didn't turn out in your marriage like you had hoped, and there's an emptiness there, there's a gnawing there. Maybe it's work, your vocation, and you had certain dreams and things never really panned out. Or school, if you're a student, you know, you feel like you're alone, you are sort of isolated. Or maybe if you're retired, this whole golden year thing isn't so golden. Or maybe it's your health. Maybe it's something in your past, or maybe in your future you feel like, oh, it's just an emptiness there that I can't resolve or deal with. Or maybe it's in your finances or in your friendships. Or maybe it's in your willpower, your ability to get through and overcome something. And there's an emptiness of trust in your life, an emptiness of hope or peace or comfort that you need. We all have something. We all have a hole, a void in us. Now, I love the words of Blaise Pascal. He was a French Christian philosopher and mathematician back in the 17th century. This is what he said. He said, "There is a God-shaped vacuum in the heart of every man which cannot be filled by any created thing, but only by God the Creator, made known through Jesus Christ." What we all do at one level or another is we try to stuff things in that hole, like putting a round peg in a square hole. It doesn't fit. It won't work. And we only realize that after we've created a habit of doing it, or we have hurt ourselves or others by doing it. You see, we easily develop bad habits, negative hang-ups, and hurt others in an effort to fill that God-shaped hole in our hearts. We all have it. And so what you need to leave here with today is the promise that God wants to fill your net. And I don't know what your net is. You and God figure that out together. He wants to fill your net. Do you want Him to fill your net? We're shown the way by the disciples. How do you get your net filled? There it is. Listen to Jesus. It's harder than it looks, right? Follow Jesus' advice. Reap His rewards, not what you want from Him. Strengthen your trust in Jesus, because you're never strong enough. Now, what about that 153? All those fish. What's that about? I told you we'd get to that before we close. It's interesting that it names 153 fish. Why would that be? There are a lot of theories, and I encourage you to go Google it later today. A lot of very interesting theories about why 153 fish. I want to share one with you that I think is really the most convicting, and that is from St. Jerome, the 4th century. This guy named Jerome, he was a priest, he was a theologian. He wrote the first version of the Bible in Latin. And I've been in the cave where he did that in Israel, by the way. It's pretty darn cool. Jerome said Plato believed there were 153 species of fish in the Sea of Galilee. And so Jerome said this. He said, so 153 represents all the people of every tribe and nation being gathered together to Jesus. Isn't that beautiful? And what about that net? The net, he said, the unbroken net is the church's capacity to hold all people, to heal all people, to fill the God-shaped hole in all people. Isn't that beautiful? What that means is there's a place for everyone in the church. There's a place for everyone. And as we come together as His body, as a covenant family, together to listen to Jesus, to follow Jesus, to reap His rewards together, and to be strengthened by Him in trust together, our nets get filled. And that, my friends, is the healing that you and I need and that we need to share with everyone, because everyone belongs in the healing embrace of our Lord. Amen? Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we are humbled by what You do, how You teach us. We thank You for Your word and for the amazing gift of the disciples who walked before us. They didn't have it easy, and neither do we. And yet, we have a gift they didn't have. We have Your word. We have all the actions and teachings of You and of them to lead us and guide us. And so, Lord, help us this day to listen better to You, to follow You more closely, to seek and to reap Your rewards, not what we want from You, and to be strengthened in our trust. And may You receive the honor, the glory, and the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all stand together this morning. Thank you.
you change everything. Lives healed, hope found here now. Jesus, you change everything. Change.
It's a wonderful prayer to sing that, isn't it? Because it's in the glory of God. If we live in the glory of God, it overshadows and dominates anything that is not in His glory. It's light shining in darkness. That's the promise. That's the hope. That's the joy of what it means to follow Jesus. And it's an incredible privilege for us to do that together as a family of faith. Listen, if there's something that's difficult in your life right now, maybe you need a moment of prayer. Maybe there's a transition, or maybe there's a challenge, or maybe there's someone else you'd like to lift up. We want you to know we have someone available to pray with you today. We have a Stephen minister. Her name is Susan Moore, and Susan will be over here next to the piano, and she would love to pray with you and walk with you through whatever that challenge might be. Don't hesitate to come forward and see Susan for prayer immediately following the service. Pastor Craig's over with the kids right now, and they're having a great time, and he wanted me to be sure to let you know that Vacation Bible School is coming up in just a couple of weeks, a few weeks, and if you want to be a part of that, it's going to be in the evening time. There are some places to sign up and to join in the fun with the kids for Vacation Bible School, so if you're interested in that, check that out in the Welcome Center today as you exit. Beloved, whatever you do, remember this, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you and be gracious to you. May the light of the Lord's countenance shine upon your face and give you peace. Go now in peace. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever, and all God's children said, Amen. Oh,
day.